We're now going to move on to our third inductee into the Hall of Fame. He too was around Peter Motley's vintage. He made his debut as a 17-year-old back in 1983. Like Motts, he had some lovely flowing blonde hair as well. He was, actually pretty fantastic in that first game as well, one of the Magpies' very best. He was fast, he was strong, he had a wonderful kick. He won the McGarry Medal in 1986, crossed over to Essendon, played in the 1990 Grand Final, which was a brutal game. He was one of the VFL's very best wingmen and the AFL's very best. Came back to the Crows in 1993, played wonderful state footy and crowned his career with a couple of flags at his beloved Magpies in 95 and 96. Congratulations to Greg Anderson.
I've been reading books of old, the legends and the myths, Achilles and his gold, Achilles and his gifts. But she said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss, just something I can turn to, somebody I can kiss. I want something just like this. Do, 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 do. Oh, I want something just like this.
Congratulations, Greg Anderson. Ando, well done, mate. Come up.
Thank you.
Up here. Now, you and Watts, obviously, all around the same vintage. But I've got to say, that 82, we talked about that 82 interstate draft. You too were picked up by the Swans like Watts in that 82 draft. So you, what, 16 years of age?
I was actually 15 when I got drafted.
15?
Yeah, along with Peter. And yep. A bit of a surprise. I didn't know what it was about, actually. I woke up in the morning some media rang me up and said, look, you've just been drafted. And I said, well, what's that mean? Yeah. I actually had no idea what was happening. But, the Sydney Swans drafted me at 15.
Did you have any consideration or any thought? I mean, you're still at school. Where were you, at St Michael's there or Woodville at that stage?
Just at St Michael's. So, just doing, I think, year 11. So, no thought at all, actually. I just wanted to play for my beloved Port Adelaide. And never thought any further than that at that stage.
Now, at that point there, you didn't have to wait long to go and make your debut for Port Adelaide as a 17-year-old. Now, have a look at you. This is you in action on debut, playing against the Double Blues. Just describe your first game because, geez, I'll tell you what, you got into it very, very quickly.
It was an amazing game. I mean, the Double Blues got the jump on us and I think we were sort of four or five down at half time, and then we turned it around beautifully in that second half and we come out victorious, which is fantastic. But, the opportunity to play with, my God, Russell Ebert and Brian Cunningham and Annie Paul Pleasure and Kimmy Kinnear, Timmy Evans, Tony Giles. They were just my childhood heroes.
Yep.
And there I was running out alongside of those guys. And, funny enough, when I stirred for that instance, they had Peter Motley and, Rick Davies, Flash Graham, what a wonderful player he was, Neil Craig, Jimmy Gerrington. So, yeah, they were just household names, and I was actually 16, just running out in the field. I was a bit overwhelmed by the whole situation, actually.
You played all right, didn't you?
I was pretty lucky. I reckon I played pretty wide.
No, you did play well, didn't you?
I did. I was at the footy club at Port Adelaide. I got second best player.
Yes.
So that was fantastic. So everything went pretty well for me for that day.
Now, obviously, at Port Adelaide there, I don't know if there were brown paper bags, but there were supporters that would come in after games and they would provide some money to the players that had played well. So you're 16 years of age.
I was 16 years of age.
How much cash did you get from the supporters that night?
Really interesting, because they started reading out my donations, and what they do is, as you go up the stairs, the supporters give some donations to their favourite player or the best player or whatever it might be. And Anyway, they started with my donations. And remember, in those days, it was $1 and $2 bills and fives. And anyway, I just topped the $1,000 mark.
In 1983,
I remember thinking, you know, I'm not too far away from buying that 180B from old Davy Boy, Datsun. I couldn't believe it.
A thousand bucks,
and it was amazing going to school the next day with a big $20 bill. So,
at the canteen,
I say, I want all those donuts, and I want all.
What about the next week? You go to Central the next week?
Went to Central. It was fantastic. It was an incredible game. We just got up and won by a couple of goals. What about the club? I'm thinking, you beauty.
Another 1,000?
Okay, got $40.
40 bucks.
That was it. Just enough to get maybe a little bit of Chinese food that night.
And then you played in a grand final the following year, lost to Norwood. But that was the Craig Balm, Tim Evans grand final, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was amazing to be on the wing and I think the national anthem was being played and then it just erupted and
yes.
Everyone was down that that goal square and having a massive go at each other, and I think they still bounced the ball, and funny enough the player that got the first kick was me.
Yeah.
I didn't find my way down that forward line. I just stayed. It's my dad always said, just play the ball, so I let the big tough guys fight that one out.
And like Mots, you took to the game as a young man really, really well and impressed him. What was a really, really tough time to play football, but it was also a great time to represent South Australia.
It was just amazing times. My first game was 1984, and I was actually speaking to Craig Bradley the other day about that. And, you know, we actually couldn't get to the game. We hit the boulevard.
Here you go, mate. This is up there on the screen.
We couldn't get to the game, and... luckily, there was a policeman that was near us, and Craig sort of yelled out to him, and he sort of came across, and he said, "Mate, we've got to get to the game. Can you help us out?" So we actually had police escort to probably more Craig than me, the police escort to the game, and I think they turned away, you know, up to close to 40,000 people. And Knuckles Curley, of course, was coaching that. We lost by a couple of points, but. It was just amazing. I mean, South Australian just stopped for their state footy, and everyone can see the vision. But some of those players were just amazing, and I was lucky enough to play for about 12 years, and then sort of towards the end there, you're sort of playing alongside of then Ricciuto and Bickley and Wren and Hart, but you're still playing alongside of your Kernahan Bradleys, your Stretchers, and those sort of players, and it was such a wonderful era for South Australia.
What do you remember of the McGarry Medal night that you won?
And I should say Peter Motley too, by the way.
Of course.
Oh my God, he was just a star. I used to love watching him. You know, when I was a kid, you know, when he was playing 81, 82, it was just outstanding and an outstanding state player. Oh my God.
And here's the McGarry Medal. Have a look. Gee, some things haven't changed, have they? You still look the same.
See, I mean, I'm probably not too far away from being from the Hall of Fame for the mullet.
Well, I didn't bring that. Have a look at that hair. Look, really,
that was the award I was winning tonight.
The fringe has grown a little since then, but everything else, remarkably, Ando, is very, very similar. Which, half your luck, because what are you? 55? Where old are you?
I just can't look at Brattles at the moment. Sorry, mate.
Because look at him, he's bald. Mate, you've still got the exact same haircut. Look at you, you've got a lush crop. You're not even going bald.
Mate,
it's remarkable.
It's
you're not
it's
grey.
It's slowly falling out, but it's. Oh, no, I only just got it cut, too. This is embarrassing.
Which one was cut?
Oh, I'm telling you, there was a lot of hair around the barber chair too, by the way. That was last week.
When your 30th birthday, didn't the boys get hold of your hair one day and actually cut it? Have you had a cut what short once?
Yeah, that was really nasty, that actually. I know Andrew Jarman was, he was the actual one that cut my hair, but it was my 30th, and there was Jarman, Pittman, Jamison were the culprits, along with Benny Hart, and I think Peter Caven, and I knew it was coming, so I didn't sort of, you know, carry on too much. I wrestled him a little bit. And then Jar's got the scissors out, and there goes the ponytail. So end up having a bit of a Jason Donovan look for a little while.
Did you lose your strength like Samson? Because you're such a powerful player. I always thought if you cut your hair, maybe you wouldn't be as powerful as you've always been. And
well, it could be, because that was from my last year with the Crows. So it could have been, actually. I sort of went downhill after that. No, I don't know. From my mother's point of view, she was just so proud of those ex-teammates, because she said, finally, you got rid of your long hair.
like Peter, like Craig, Johnny Platton, Stephen Kernahan, so many players that went across the border. You eventually went there before you knew that there was going to be a South Australian team here. I want to take you back. We found this little bit of vision from a long time ago. This is 1990. Of course, you guys play in a grand final a bit later in the year. And you were taking the VFL back then as it was. No, it was AFL in 89. So you're taking the AFL by storm. Let's have a look at this little story with Louis the Lip Richards.
At only 23, Greg Anderson has the world at his feet. Together with fiancée Karen and three-year-old son Dylan, the star bomber has just moved onto a 12-acre property at Buller. I hope he had an easier time finding the place than I did. Anderson was best on ground by far in last Sunday's crunching win over Hawthorne, a win that came a lot easier than anyone expected. It didn't take him long to tune into the Victorian way of football, and what a reception he gets with his aerial work. Well, the kid's got a great piece of real estate out here, and Greg Anderson is becoming one of the hottest properties in league football. And I'll tell you what, I bet the bombers hope that he's got a mortgage on the wide open spaces of the MCG on Monday.
Mate, that's you still look the same. It's quite remarkable. But for those people that, you know, were living here in that time, I remember as a young boy watching you play, you were a big deal in Victoria very, very early on. You found your feet like Pete did straight away.
What I did notice, I never really looked to pass off, did I?
No, well, you didn't need to, mate. You just finished because you were such a good kick.
I went for goal every single time. I'm looking at Paul Seven now and he knows that for a fact.
But it was amazing because you went in there straight away, and that was the thing. I think you look at South Australian football and what this Hall of Fame showcases, so many of the players in this Hall of Fame went over and made an impact straight away. And you obviously, some of you waited a couple of years. But did you find it an easy step? And how high was the step up?
Oh, it was a pretty tough step. I mean, it was just so competitive, and that's what I really found when I first went to the Essendon Footy Club. I'm fighting for someone's position, and there was, sort of six, seven guys as big as me and as strong as me and as fast, and we're all vying for the same position. So that was the first hurdle, and then you've got to perform, and you're up against Dipper Domenico's, your Mullanes, your Tommy Alvins, your Gavin Browns. I mean, there's so many superstars that you're up against week in, week out, and I think that was probably the one thing that every week was just such a huge challenge.
Like Motts, you too played in the grand final pretty quickly in your career there. This is 1990, just some of the vision here. You played against Mullane, was around the area at the time, and this game got pretty brutal, didn't it?
It was pretty nasty, actually.
Where are you now?
Well, I'm sort of running in.
Yeah.
You'll see me in a minute being a big, strong, tough hero, but no, I wasn't.
So you've got Darren Mullane next to you, haven't you, when you're coming in?
I actually followed Mullane in because I thought he was going probably a lot faster than I thought he should be, because he was really targeting, one of the Essendon players. So I sort of ran in pretty quickly. And, obviously looking at that footage there, it was horrible for football.
Yeah.
I think it was, not a great spot.
Dave Grenvold, there's
David
another
Grenvold
South Australian
and Derek
in
Kickett,
there.
Of course, the Longy was there, Tony Francis. So, you're talking, six or seven, eight South Australians
in that
grand final. Yeah.
And, of course, you didn't get the chance to win that 1991. You came back, played with Adelaide, wonderful footy again, your state footy, you're all Australian. But you finally got the taste of a flag. So 84, you didn't get the chance to win. Yeah. You had that one. You lost the 93 prelim.
Yeah.
But, geez, 95 and 96 must have been sweet alongside Timmy G and a few other boys.
Yeah, it was three really special things that I remember. And firstly, the siren, and you won your grand final. It was, for me, a childhood dream when you went for Port Adelaide. The second one was certainly my mother coming down from the grandstand. I knew she was where her seats were, right at the back there. And by the time I won my medal, and we were just about to do the lap of honour, my mum came over and gave me a huge hug. And that's a memory I'll always, always keep. And the third, I was really lucky. The next morning I woke up and the photo on the Sunday Mail was me sort of hugging John Carl. And that was something really, really special. And, a great memory that I keep on the wall, that's for sure.
Did you feel that relief because you'd had such a wonderful career and you had so many individual honours, but to finally get one?
Oh, look, no question. And I know the guys are sitting there saying, well, I know the Port table's in there in a couple of weeks, and I think we've got Glenelgan, the Crows, they'll be, vying for that spot in the grand final. It's just something so special. And to finally win one was, like I said, a dream come true. And look, as a kid, I was just a crazy Port supporter. To have John Carl, as I said, embrace me after the game was something pretty special, along with, all those wonderful teammates like Tinny Jennifer and plenty others as well.
Greg Anderson, congratulations
Thank
on
you
a wonderful
much.
Career, mate. I'll hand over to you.
Yeah, like Peter, what a huge honour. I mean, I sort of, when I received the letter, I just pinched myself. I really did. I couldn't believe it, and just so honoured. But I just, you know, wanted to thank, of course, my parents. It's incredible, you know, when you look back how much time they put into your career. And Dad, it's so great that you're here tonight, it really is. So, Dad, thank you. To my wife, Helen, my kids, Dylan, Brittany, Ashley and Jasmine, thanks for your support. And actually, it's been a lot of fun, especially my three daughters getting organised for tonight. To the Port Adelaide Footy Club, what an incredible club. And as a young boy, as I said before, I was a crazy Port supporter. And the players, honestly, were my superheroes. You know, Russ Leavitt, Brian Cunningham, Timmy Evans, Brucey Light. I had 26 on my back. I was very lucky there. Carl Fregamini, Peter Woit, Daryl Cale, and, of course, you know, John Cale, just to name a few. You know, they really were just heroes for me, a boy from Cheltenham. And at 16, to be able to put on the black and white lace-up for his first senior game, it was a dream come true, and it was a great win against Sturt. To the Essendon Footy Club, you know, what a powerhouse of a club. I remember the first few games into my first season playing against Collingwood, and I ran out to the MCG in front of 70,000 supporters singing, "Wow, welcome to the big league," and what a great club to call, you know, that I'm part of and I call home. To the Adelaide Footy Club, you know, back then it was one team, one town, and being a very proud South Australian to be able to represent your state week in, week out, it was such a great honour and just a huge thrill. And playing with guys, you know, like Renner, McGuinness, McDermott, Hart, Jarman, Smart, Rusciuto, Jamison, Bickley, you know, they were just fantastic players and wonderful teammates. Also to the South Adelaide Footy Club, what an incredible honour to be the head senior coach. And I remember the club had only just moved to their new home, Hickenbotham Oval, down at Noarlunga. And it was, you know, like, you know, starting over again, really. With lots of hard work by many Southies to build the club up in the new community. And the record really does show that especially the last 10 decades, how strong a club they are in the SNFL. To all the players that I've met throughout footy, just been so many fantastic teammates, administrators, staff, and all the footy supporters that enjoy coming up and having a chat. It's wonderful. And I always remember, you know, one night with Graham Corns being our coach with the Crows, I remember him saying, "You're playing the greatest game in the world," and there are no truer words. It's a wonderful game, and I thank you so much for this great honour. Thank you very much.
Congratulations to Greg Anderson. Fantastic.